Alberta's oil sands. It's the world's third largest oil reserve, 161 billion barrels of recoverable oil in the ground. They're a huge part of Canada's economy, contributing trillions to Canada's GDP over the past 50 years, generating billions annually in government taxes, revenues, and royalties, supporting small and medium-sized businesses from coast to coast, and attracting hundreds of thousands of workers from every part of the country. But how much do you know about the oil sands? Alberta's oil sands are contained within the Western Canadian Sedimentary Basin, which formed from the decomposition of plants and marine life about 200 million years ago, when Western Canada was believed to be mostly underwater. Microbacteria contained within the oxygenated water fed off the lighter hydrocarbon molecules, leaving behind a heavy, complex hydrocarbon known as bitumen. There are an estimated 1.8 trillion barrels of oil in the oil sands, but only 10% of those barrels can be economically recovered with current technology. That works out to 161 billion barrels of recoverable oil in the ground. To put those numbers into context, the industry currently extracts about a billion barrels a year, accounting for two-thirds of Canada's total oil production. Oil sands are a loose, unconsolidated mixture of sand, clays, and water saturated with bitumen. Oil sands are mostly coarse silica sand, about 80%. Fine solids and clays make up 5%, water is another 5%, while bitumen saturation rates average about 10%. Bitumen is a hydrocarbon compound with a very long and very complex molecular structure. Bitumen is high in carbon, low in hydrogen, and contains a relatively high amount of sulfur and heavy metals, especially nickel and vanadium. Bitumen is an extra-heavy oil and contains as much as 20% asphaltenes, which are complex hydrocarbon compounds with a very high molecular weight. Asphaltenes are what make bitumen thick, viscous, and almost solid at room temperatures, giving bitumen that smell of tar or asphalt. While all crudes contain asphaltenes, bitumen has more asphaltenes than conventional oil, and even more than heavy conventional oil. To make oil from the oil sands, first, you extract the bitumen from the sand, then you either upgrade or dilute that bitumen into a marketable crude product, which can then be shipped to a refinery for final processing. There are two ways to extract bitumen from the oil sands, either by pumping steam into the ground, which is referred to as in-situ extraction, or through surface mining. The method used depends on the depth of the deposit. For deposits located deep underground, steam is pumped into a well which extends deep into the reservoir. This steam heats up the reservoir, reducing the viscosity of the bitumen, allowing it to be pumped up to the surface. This mixture of bitumen and condensed steam is then sent to a processing plant, where the water is separated from the bitumen, cleaned up, and sent back to the steam plant, leaving behind a very clean bitumen product. There are two types of in-situ technologies. The original cyclic steam stimulation facilities, which use a single well for both steaming and bitumen production, and the more common steam-assisted gravity drainage facilities, which use separate wells for steam injection and bitumen production. Both produce a clean, marketable bitumen, which is diluted and sold to market as a heavy oil blend. About 20% of Alberta's oil sands are too close to the surface to be extracted in situ. In this case, traditional mining technology is used to recover the bitumen. The mined oil sands is trucked to a processing plant using very large haul trucks. The deposit is loosely crushed and then conveyed to a bitumen production facility where it's mixed with hot water, producing a pumpable slurry. Coarse sand is gravity separated from the bitumen and sent to a temporary tailing storage pond where the water can be recovered back to the process plant. Bitumen froth from extraction, which still contains a lot of water and fine solids, is then mixed with a light hydrocarbon, which reduces the viscosity of the bitumen, liberating most of the remaining fines and water, leaving behind a relatively clean bitumen product. There are two types of mining facilities, distinguished by the type of hydrocarbon used to clean the bitumen froth: the original naphthenic facilities, and the newer paraffinic facilities. NFT bitumen has way too much water and solids to be pipelined very far, so that bitumen goes to a nearby upgrader. However, PFT bitumen is very clean, so it's typically diluted with condensate and sold directly to a refinery without being upgraded. Since bitumen from a traditional NFT mining facility has too much water and solids, it can't be diluted to meet pipeline specifications, so it can't be shipped very far. This bitumen therefore has to get processed in an upgrader, which is usually located very close to the mine site. Aside from removing the solids, water, and hydrocarbon used in froth treatment, upgraders convert the bitumen residue, which is the sludge left behind after crude distillation. Unlike the gas oil fractions, which are used to make gasoline and diesel, residue doesn't evaporate very easily and will produce a lot of lower value asphalt at the refinery. And since bitumen is an extra heavy oil, it will produce a lot more sludge, even more than conventional heavy oil. Upgraders basically upgrade or convert this residue into higher value gas oils using equipment like crackers, cokers, and hydroconversion units, which basically break up the long chain hydrocarbon bonds and improve the hydrogen to carbon ratio, either by removing carbon or adding hydrogen. This converts the low-value residue into higher-value naphtha and gas oils. The last step in the upgrading process is to take all of these streams and remove contaminants that were originally contained in the bitumen, such as sulfur and nitrogen. After this cleaning step, each stream is recombined into a final crude oil product known as synthetic crude, which is a very clean, residue-free, light, sweet crude. So just to recap, there are almost 30 in-situ facilities and two PFT mining facilities that produce 2 million barrels per day of marketable bitumen, which is diluted and sold as a dilbit blend, and four mining facilities which send their bitumen to four upgraders, which produce about 1 million barrels per day of synthetic crude. That all works out to about 3.5 million barrels per day of crude, which is sold to refineries, including the diluent portion. Starting with the 1 million barrels of light synthetic crude, about half gets used in Canada, mostly Alberta, and the other half gets exported to the US, mostly the Midwest, with smaller volumes going to Washington State. As for the 2.5 million barrels of dilbit that come from the oil sands, only a smidge goes to Canada. The bulk of it goes to the US. And a large portion of that, more than two-thirds, ends up in the Midwest region because, well, that's just where the pipelines go. Well, Canada has a lot of upgraders, which are basically partial refineries. So Canadian refineries are better suited for synthetic crude, which has already been partially refined. So that's why very little bitumen is processed in Canada. To process bitumen, you need a very complex refinery, basically a refinery with a built-in upgrader, just like the ones found in the US. Western Canada has six crude export pipelines, all originating from Alberta: Trans Mountain, which runs to the west coast, Rangeland, Milk River, and Express, which run south to the Rocky Mountains region and connect to the Midwest, Keystone, which connects to the Gulf Coast via the Midwest, and Mainline, which runs to the Midwest and also connects to the Gulf Coast. Well, let's look at the math. Excluding space for products, the six pipelines have a total capacity of about 4 million barrels per day of crude. Western Canada makes 4.8 million barrels, including diluent and conventional oil volumes, and regional refining capacity is about 600,000 barrels per day. So that leaves 4.2 million barrels per day to be shipped out to other customers. So yeah, Canada is a bit short, at least until the Trans Mountain expansion comes online in 2023. Alberta makes a lot of dilbit, over 3.5 million barrels per day, but local demand is very low, like 90,000 barrels. So all that excess has to be exported. And when the pipelines are full, producers have to either store their oil or ship the extra barrels on rail cars. And that all adds to the cost of shipping that oil to the customer, which drops the oil price in Alberta. Yes, there are many different oil prices depending on grade and demand for that particular grade at a particular location. In Alberta, for example, the heavy oil discount averaged $13 a barrel in 2021, whereas in Houston, that differential was only $5. That's because there's very little heavy oil demand in Alberta and lots of supply. But heavy oil is very scarce in the Gulf Coast, while refinery demand for heavy oil is very, very high. If you're looking at the same grade, WCS for example, then the price differentials reflect the cost of shipping that marginal barrel to the final customer. So for WCS, that would basically be the cost of shipping that crude by pipeline, assuming no other constraints in the system. In 2019, the oil sands emitted 84 megatons of CO2 equivalent. That worked out to about 15% of Canada's total emissions. Those emissions are split about half from in-situ operators and the other half from mining and bitumen upgrading. Most of those emissions are from the burning of natural gas for steam and power production, especially for in-situ operators. Diesel-powered haul trucks and tailings ponds are a big source for mine operators, while upgraders burn fuel to heat the bitumen feedstock to high temperatures. From extraction to the point of combustion, the average US barrel emits about 500 kilos of CO2 equivalent per barrel. Remember that extraction methods are only a small part of total emissions. Most of the carbon contained in a barrel of oil are released at the point of combustion. So the average barrel refined in the US is actually on par with mature SAGD facilities like Cenovus's Christina Lake and non-upgraded oil sands mines like Imperial's Kuril Mine. Aside from improvements in efficiencies and technology advancements, getting to zero emissions will likely come through carbon capture and storage. All of the major oil sands producers have committed to being net zero by 2050 in support of the federal government's mandate.
Wow, that was a very quick 10-minute run through Alberta's oil sands industry. Hi, my name is Anna. I'm the editor of Oil Sands Magazine. If you're looking for something more detailed, I would invite you to check out our 101 short course, which is in a similar format but a much slower pace. The course runs for about 2 hours and includes a downloadable PDF technical guide and a transcript of the videos with links to references and further reading material. And for a deeper dive into any of these topics, you can always check out the technical library on our website, which is totally free. I'll leave the links below. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.